Jeremy, it's great to see you.
You too, Steve. How are you doing?
I'm doing fantastic. Well, hey, let's jump into this. And why don't we start with you telling me about your practice? What kind of business do you have? Do you have a specific focus that you target? What's it look like today?
Yeah, so with the Keil Financial Partners, and all we do is retirement planning. That's our main focus. That's been my focus for quite some time. Absolutely love it. I figure it's a huge decision that people are making going into retirement. A lot of the decisions, you can't reverse it. And so we want to help people make some good decisions on there. So been a financial advisor for 18 years, got a few staff members, got an advisor who also has a CFP designation, and he's helping out with a lot of our clients right now as well.
Yeah, well, you and I have known each other for a few years. We do some work together. And so I know a fair amount about your practice here. And where I think we want to focus today is talking about marketing, because I know you've done a great job in the marketing area. And so let's explore that. So why don't we talk about, let's say, what were you doing before COVID hit? And then what have you been doing since COVID hit? And was there any difference in terms of how you were marketing because of that?
Yeah, absolutely. In a way, our marketing pre-COVID versus post-COVID, all we did is basically took what we were doing beforehand and doubled the spend, doubled the time on it. A lot of the things we were doing was online. And so a lot of the interest kicked up. Whenever the market's all of a sudden not looking too good, people realize it's time to call an advisor, and just more and more people are doing that online. But one thing about my approach to marketing is I believe you should not do marketing until you do a few other things first. Our order of operations, in a way, is number one, focus on your branding, which is who you are and who you serve. Number two, work on your messaging, which is how you speak to who you serve. And then number three, then you do your marketing, which is how you find who you serve. So it's nice on our end that we've gone through a branding exercise, we've gone through messaging and knew what type of messages we wanted to get out to the people that we serve. And we're already at that point. So when COVID hit, in a manner of speaking, it was just a matter of dialing up the volume and just turning up the dial and the amount of marketing on the down amount of marketing we were putting in there, because we knew the channels to go after and the messages to go after. So it's far more impactful to do the marketing after we had done the first two exercises of branding and messaging.
Well, let's go into the branding and messaging a little bit, because I know you put together a new website here not that long ago. Tell me about your thought process when you put the new website together. How did you think about the branding? How did you think about the messaging? What did you do differently with the new website to make sure that it was really focused on your target market?
Yeah, well, our target market is people getting ready to make decisions on their retirement. So people that are basically 55 to 65 is a general range there. And part of our branding on our new website was we're joining or becoming an independent advisory firm. We're part of a network that we're affiliated with, the Thrivent Advisor Network. But with that, we get to create our own brand and do things the way that we'd like to do. And so we had to go out and create a brand in a way. People knew me as my name before and with the group I was with before, but they didn't know my brand, who I was. So number one, we had to come up with a name. And the only requirement I told my branding folks was absolutely do not name it after me. And you might have guessed that that's exactly what they came back with. And when they went through it, they said, well, people do already know you. And at the time, it was myself and an associate advisor. And in a way, I was the brand, and I believe them, I pay them, they know what they're doing. And so we went along with the Keil Financial Partners as my name. But like the idea of the partners, because it's a partnership with our clients, it's a partnership with the advisors that are with us. And they said, you know what, if you get to the point where you have 10 advisors with you, yeah, you'll have plenty of time and revenue to go ahead and change your name at that point in time. So that's just an interesting exercise. I came into it with some preconceived notions, but thankfully trusted the experts. It's worked out pretty well with that. But a lot of things are just focusing on what is it that people need. And my thought is when people hit retirement, they need more of a consultant than a coach. Now, I know you're a business coach, but my opinion of when people are hitting retirement is they need a consultant. So we try to show that we are consultative. We try to show that we have some authority. We know what we're talking about. Try to show that we have some empathy, that we've helped people go through this process before. And so a lot of the images on the website, a lot of the words are along what people are looking for. People are looking for retirement planning, investment planning, tax planning. And we want to show smiling, happy people, because once they work with us, I'm hoping they will be smiling, happy people afterwards, especially after they go through our retirement planning process.
I've got your website pulled up here, and I noticed that you've got a number of buttons on there, so you make it real easy for people to reach out to you. So you've got a button that says start here. You've got schedule a free call. You've got schedule a free call. So you've got that in several places. And then you also, pretty prominently on the homepage, it says create a consistent retirement income with our 5-step retirement income process. So tell me about the thinking behind having something specific like that and talking about a 5-step process. What were you trying to accomplish by having something that specific?
You get it. I'm not sure where I heard it, but somebody said in a podcast, I listened to quite a few of those, but somebody had said once, people want to know your doing process and your buying process. And so you want to make it easier for people to reach out to you if that's what they want to do. Schedule a free call makes it easy for people to reach out to me. But people also want to know, well, what will it look like? What will you do? So we've got a button on there called Our Process. When people are looking for a retirement planner, it's good for them to understand how will we help them solve these issues that they have. And so having that 5-step retirement income process is a great way for people to be able to know what they're getting into. I think that differentiates us from some other advisors that are out there that maybe slightly copy just what the CFP board says to do, or they say we're holistic and comprehensive. Well, what does that mean? If you meet two or three people saying we do holistic comprehensive planning, and you meet us and we say, we help you find your retirement plan in 5 steps that we'll walk through along with you, then it's a lot more easier to go along with. It's a lot more easier in their mind to actually take the steps that they need to take to make their retirement happen on there. That's the thing behind it is really, it's almost what's the new word, user experience. That's the new phrase these days with especially websites, is you want to make it a good user experience. And I think with your planning, if you want people to take change and take action, then having a good user experience for them is a good way to go. And knowing what's ahead of them, knowing this is the process we're going to take, is going to make them a lot more comfortable with working with you, and also a lot more comfortable with having a confident retirement.
One other thing I see that you've got on your homepage, it says how to create your retirement income plan. And then below that, you've got meet, create, and optimize. So you've got 3 pieces to that. And I think using things in threes is always a good idea. But I also like how you said how to create your retirement plan. And I see this often with financial advisors. One of the most powerful words that you can put in your messaging is you or your or yours. And just a simple addition of that word can have a huge impact, because then the person who's coming to the website, it says, oh, you're speaking to me. And and so just a little tweak like that. So I like how you have that in there. So anything else that you want to add on this, how to create your retirement income plan, any other thought process behind that piece?
Yeah. Well, with that specifically, that's our how do you work with us process. We had the doing process. We talked about our 5-step retirement income plan. But how do you actually go about and work with Keil Financial Partners? Well, it says right there, you can meet us. And we say right there, grill us on our expertise. So we're trying to say, hey, we're an open book. Come and figure out if we got the goods. And then just even having the expertise kind of shows that we've got the confidence that we think we are experts in this field. And it is all about your goals and finances. We've got a plan that'll help you put your retirement puzzle together. And then we want people to understand it's not a one-time deal. That each year we're looking at your income, your investment, your tax opportunities. So it really gives them a flavor just right there. And I don't know, was that 25 words total maybe overall right there? Just here's how we work together. And again, just makes them a lot more comfortable with picking up the phone on there. Although real quick, you might be asking me the next thing, because right below there is a lead generating PDF if you follow the marketing rules. And the idea there is you want to add some value. So if people are wanting to check out the website, kylefp.com, got no problem checking it out. My search engine guy will be thinking what did wonders to our web traffic. But on there, we've got a guidebook. It says 6 questions retirees aren't asking but should be. And it tells a little bit about what you'll get out of there. But if you want the guidebook, you have to give us your first name and your email. So we're showing some value that we'll give to you. We get a little value back by having their first name and email. It's about 12 pages and goes through different things you should be using when you get ready for retirement, or questions and things you should be looking at when you're getting ready for retirement. So that's a huge helpful thing for people to, they don't want to necessarily give us a call right away, but they want to see our work. And that's kind of a proof of our work and our concepts and how we go about things. And real quick on that, what's interesting is, of course, you know this stuff, Steve, but you put your name in there, your email, you get kicked into a nurture sequence, it's called, in the marketing world. Well, we've done that about 100 times in the last year. So it's, I don't know, decent enough number, 100 people have been on there. And just recently, and people get a response immediately from our marketing software. Just recently, I've been, every single time one of those comes through, maybe once or twice a week, I'll just send a personal email. It's almost exactly the same thing as what the marketing software kicks out. But I just send out a personal email real quick, and it says, thanks for checking us out. What questions do you have? And the last two people I've done that to, both of them were referred to us, went to our website, didn't give us a call. They knew our name, they knew where to get us, but they didn't give us a call right away. They wanted to check us out first. They checked us out through the guidebook that they downloaded. And because I had their first name and email, I could reach out to them, and they both responded back and said, well, here are the questions. And the one I've met twice now by Zoom, because we're all on Zoom right now in this world. The other one responded back and forth with some emails, and she's booked next week. So it's really interesting that here are referrals that did not give us a call, that I did not ask for, that they went to our website. They still weren't comfortable actually giving us a call then after checking us out. But the fact that I had something of value to give to them got me their name and their email. And then I got to reach out, have a little conversation, and just made the whole process a lot easier, more comfortable for them, kind of putting them in control, which we might talk about a little bit later on, of putting the clients in control in a way. But that's just been fun to see that all the pieces together working out in concert.
Yeah, I think that's an important point, in that obviously today we've got websites. And so people are going to check you out on the website first. And so that's one reason why you kind of have a pretty darn good website. Mm-hmm. And the website can do a lot of the pre-selling. If you've got a great website, if you've got the downloads like you talk about, if you've got a podcast, which you do, and we'll probably talk about that here in just a little bit, if you've got video on there. And so by the time someone is ready to reach out and pick up the phone or shoot you an email, they know you pretty well. And you know, you're going to have to kind of screw it up at that point if they're making the effort mm-hmm. to reach out to you, because they've done this due diligence. And so having the great website is important. And that's why I wanted to spend a few minutes here talking about your website, because I know you've been very thoughtful and intentional about what you put in there. So I appreciate you, you know, telling us some of the things that you've done there. So let's segue here over to some of the marketing ideas that you're mm-hmm. doing. You mentioned the importance of having the branding and the messaging first and getting clear on that. So let's talk maybe a little more tactical about what are you doing on the marketing side to get people to actually reach out to you?
Yeah, well, I'm going to give you a couple of stories, still a little bit on the website, but I think it relates to it. One of these two people that I just mentioned there, and I reached out by email because they came to our website and checked us out, is when I talked to him, he said, when I went to your website, everything that's on there is exactly what I'm looking for. You gave me all kinds of information. I've read some of your blogs. I've listened to some of your podcasts. You've got your process right there. I've been calling some financial advisors. I've been asking for this information. I can't even get it from them. So he's been looking for somebody to give him some value. And he said, you gave that to me before you even knew who I was. So that was just a huge lift to our prospects of working together, in that he's been calling advisors saying, hey, what do you do? What do you charge? And then here we are telling people, what do we do and how we go about charging and all kinds of things on the website. So it just added a huge amount of credibility that we gave away a lot of that value before he found what he's looking for without even having to ask it. So that was such good feedback. I loved hearing that when he told us that.
Yeah. And I think there's two really important things that highlights. One is that if your messaging is on point, it should speak directly to the people that you want to work with. So when someone goes to your website and they look at that and they see the messaging, they should be like raising their hand and saying, oh my gosh, you're speaking exactly to me. And so what you've done here with your focus on retirement income planning, you're very clear on who it is that you want to target. So if that person comes to your website, they're immediately going to say, ah, this person's speaking my language. So I think that's a key thing. And then the second really important thing that I think you mentioned there was you were giving first. And mm-hmm. so you were giving value. You've got the downloads here. You've got your podcast episodes on there. So you're giving them tremendous value before you're even asking for them to do anything for you or to become a client. And so I think that's another important thing, is we've got to give before we really, before we have the right to ask for their business. Yeah,
you got it.
And I think that's just the way we need to be here in a service business. So I think that is an important piece. And another thing, maybe a third thing here is I think you mentioned you have your pricing on the website. Is that right?
That one, I dither back and forth on whether it should be on the website or not, but we go through on there, here's how we could work together. We can work together on planning and investments together. We can work together just on your investments if that's what you prefer. And we can do kind of consulting type, pay us by the hour, that type of stuff. So people do realize there's different ways that we can go about working together on there. Cause it's not quite fully 100% transparent, I gotta say, but it's a step in the right direction.
Yeah.
And it's helpful people knowing ahead of time of, well, you've got some choices and they can ask questions and talk about it from there.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to push you and I'm going to push everyone that's listening here, put your pricing on your website. And I just think that's important as a financial advisor that people want to know, well, how do you charge for your services and what do you charge? Now, I know there's a school of thought that says, don't tell your pricing before you show what your value is. Mm-hmm. But if you're confident in what you do and in what you deliver, and you're giving before you're asking, I think it's really helpful to have your pricing on there. And there definitely are advisors who do put their pricing on the website, mm-hmm. and I think they have an advantage.
Yeah.
And if someone is going to look at your pricing and they're going to say, oh, they're priced too high, I'm going to go elsewhere. Well, then that tells you that this is a price shopper, and that's probably not who you want to work with anyway. But if you've got a great website, you've got great material, you've got great value there, and you can be clear in what you're charging and why you're charging that, I think that's important. So
I hear you with that. I'll tell you real quick, if hopefully this is helpful for folks, is that here's the reason why I haven't done that. And that I've gone to some presentations or heard people talk and they say, you're an advisor, you can do a whole lot of different things. And you should almost have like a menu of services so that people can go through and choose, here's what I want from you. And I disagree with that somewhat. We're not McDonald's, we're not a Starbucks, we're more like doctors. And it's not as if you go to the doctor, at least you shouldn't go to the doctor and say, I'd like one of your x-rays, please. You ought to go to the doctor and tell them what it is that you might need. They ought to be really good at asking questions to figure out what you need that you haven't said yet. And then the doctor should prescribe the manner of going about it. So we focus very much on learning a lot more about what the clients need. And you can tell if you've got the training in a way, if you're a good listener, and I'm sure we'll talk about that later on. But if someone comes in and they're talking about needing somebody to do a consulting arrangement, they're just trying to find an hourly financial planner, why would you even bother telling that I can charge you 1.1% at $1 million? Just go ahead and say, well, this is what you need and this is what we charge for it. And if someone else comes in and says, I got $500,000 to roll over, I just need a plan. Can you help me out with all of it? Say, absolutely. And this is how we go about doing that. And so we found that offering all three is a great thing. The idea of hourly planning and maybe like a consulting project fee basis, and then an advisory fee that encompasses everything is great because you can help more people that way. But my philosophy so far has been discover what it is they need and make sure that you focus on that, as opposed to letting them just choose the menu, because they might choose wrong. And our approach is we're the doctor, we're the lawyer, we're the accountant, and it's our professional duty to steer them towards the right manner of even working with us.
Right. Yeah. No, I agree in terms of you're the one who should be recommending what is going to be most appropriate for them in terms of what they need. And I'm just suggesting that I think it's helpful to have the pricing out there. And I know not everyone's going to do that, and that's totally fine. But I do think there's some advantages to that, even if it's ranges. Like if you do charge an hourly fee, it may be, hourly fees range from $250 an hour to $750 an hour, depending on the complexity and which of our professionals in our organization is going to be working with you. So at least they've got some idea of what it might be, because otherwise they may just, skip you and go to the next one if they're thinking, oh, this person's going to be way too expensive for me. So anyway, great. Well, I think, enough there on the pricing piece. So let's talk a little bit about some of the tactical things that you're doing, whether it's the podcasting, whether it's the paid advertising that you're doing, or the webinars that you're doing. So where would you like to start on some of the more marketing?
Well, let's start with the podcasting, because that's branding. That's helping with our brand. That's creating an idea of who we are and how we approach things. It's helping people get used to us and the way that we go about it. That helps with the messaging, with the marketing. I never would have expected it, but we've had people call us from California, Nebraska, Michigan. Here we are in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, that found our podcast online and have called us, and some of them become clients. So it's just, I was not expecting that this quickly, within a year or so of starting the podcast, that we'd have random people calling us off the podcast. And that's the only reason that they've connected to us, is from that podcast specifically. So that's been great. But related to the podcast, another thing with that is it just enhances the other marketing that you're doing. So the number one way that we get new clients, or I'd say at least it used to be the number one way we used to get clients, is by purchasing leads online. So you get the places, especially Smart Asset, Wiser Advisor, where you buy the lead, and it's somebody that's supposedly interested in retirement planning or investing or whatnot. You're not the only one buying the lead. There's two other advisors that they're selling it to. And then you're in this competition to go ahead and try to become their advisor. And we found that it's a profitable way to go. You're hitting people exactly when they are interested in looking for your services. But having the podcast has helped us out immensely in that. So a couple of ways it's done that is, oddly enough, the first day I dropped the podcast on a Wednesday, first one ever. And then the next day on a Thursday, somebody came into us, a Smart Advisor lead, called them and started talking with them. Turns out they're in marketing. I said, hey, can you do me a favor? I just released my first podcast ever. Will you listen to it? I'll send you the podcast and then let me know what you think. And she was somebody that needed to have an appointment, talk about her retirement and investments, things like that. So I booked her, and that was the next Tuesday. She came in Tuesday. She said, I listened to your first three podcasts. That's what we want. How do we get started? That's great. The podcast, she had listened to me for basically 75 minutes of her life, which is 75 minutes more of her life than the other advisors had, because we had the podcast. We had a personal way to talk to her about specifically what she needed. So it worked out so great that the brand, the messaging, the marketing right there was on point, that I only got her name as a lead because I had paid for it. She went online looking for investment and retirement planning, but having that podcast just really, grease the wheels in a way of the sales process there, if you want to call it the sales process. And she felt a lot more comfortable. She knew what she's getting into. She was just ready to get started because she had that podcast, which is amazing.
Yeah. And of course, I'm a huge fan of a podcast. I've got a few of them and done a few of them. And I found exactly the same thing. So with my podcast, it's been a great way to get new coaching clients, because people listen to my podcast and they say, hey, it's clear, you know what you're talking about. You pretty much know everybody in the industry. And so you and I should talk. And so it's been a great, generation of new coaching clients from that standpoint. But also looking at yours, tell me about the focus of that podcast, and how does the focus of your podcast tie in again with the brand messaging that you have on the website, and how it really targets the specific people that you're trying to reach here? Because I think you've done a nice job of thinking of your marketing as a whole system. Mm-hmm. And you've got each of the components of this marketing system that are all driving toward the same ultimate North Star here.
Yeah. And with that too, what's nice, and I know you've said that clients don't like to be scaled. I've heard that on your podcast a time.
Only fish
before.
Do.
Exactly.
And mountains.
Exactly. And neither one of them like it. You like it more to scale the fish than the fish does.
That's right.
So we got busy enough that I was doing basically the sales, if you want to call that, and the advising. Well, we wanted to focus on unique abilities. And I had somebody come on board named Brad, who works part-time, was in the banking industry for years. So he knows finances, but it's not as if he was a financial advisor for 30 years. And so he's listened to all my podcasts. And when one of these Smart Advisor leads or Wiser Advisor leads comes through, he can talk to them and say, learn what they're looking for. And if they talk about Social Security or tax planning, he says, I've got a podcast for you. And he sends them that specific podcast, or he sends them this other podcast or this blog. And so basically I'm imparting my expertise onto Brad, and he's learning it a lot quicker because of the podcast, because of the blogs, and he's able to spread it a lot quicker to the people. So that's just been a phenomenal thing. Even too, as we get new advisors, new staff, what's a better training on how you go about doing the process than go ahead and listen to my 35 podcasts, right? They're driving into work, they can listen to your podcast and learn a whole lot more about you and how you approach your marketing and how your messaging, the words that you use, they'll start using your words as well too. And if you've got a a firm with more than one advisor, you want to have the same type of messaging. So that's been a great thing. But with the pre-COVID, post-COVID, a question you had earlier, basically,
well, before we jump into that, let me ask you one more question here about the podcast, some specifics in terms of how frequently do you publish the podcast? Is this a show where it's just you talking about a topic, mm-hmm. or are you interviewing people, or do you have a guest host, or how does that work?
Yeah, you got it. So I make use of Top Advisor Marketing. They've been a big help to us with starting the podcast, and they've done a good job of kind of growing me along the way. So they started out with a host that was interviewing me. And then once I got comfortable with some of that in the first few shows, then we started bringing on some guests and had that host interviewing the guest. And now I'm interviewing the guest, and that host now, I introduce him more as the producer. So it used to be that he was the, in a way, he's called me the host, but it really was him in a way on there. And now I'm hosting it, and he's kind of the color commentary as the producer on there. So it's been a great growing experience that way. And what's interesting with the podcast is bringing on some different guests, learning a whole lot of things my own end, having our clients learn a lot of things and our prospects learn a lot of things. But it's just growing the network, growing the marketing. On Google Podcasts right now, we're floating around in the top 10 for retirement-focused podcasts in Google. And I wasn't even close to it until I started having guests on. And then I brought a couple of guests on, and perhaps through their network or through some of the topics, all of a sudden we started trending up to the top 10 in the Google Podcast for retirement. So if you go to Google Podcast, type in retirement, you ought to see Retirement Revealed, our podcast, somewhere in that top 10 there. But with that, it's great. It's nice because we offload the things that we aren't the experts at to the people who are the experts at it. I can focus on the content piece of it. Every 2 weeks, a new podcast comes out. We have a companion blog that comes out a week afterwards on that, and they help us do some social media marketing. So they'll create posts and put it onto Facebook, put it onto LinkedIn. And like you said, it's a big package overall. It's the idea that everything works together. The podcast helps the blog, which helps people get to the website, and then the guidebooks helps people get involved. And it's just a good virtuous circle in a way.
Right. And a couple of things there. So one is, I love the idea of having guests on the show because they, as you mentioned, they might have some social media reach. They might be able to generate more people listening to the podcast. They might promote it as well, and they might become a client. So you got a lot of benefits there. And then the second, talk a little bit more about the repurposing of the content and how that cycle works. Do you start with the podcast first and then you create content from that? Or do you create content first and then you turn that into a podcast? And how does that work with repurposing the content?
Yeah, I love the word repurposing because that it generally starts with a podcast. But if there's an idea that hits my head because a client asked it or an article that I read about is there, I know it's a good topic, we'll write it down. And then we can I can take an approach to build out maybe an outline for a podcast. And then from there you build out the blogs and the social media and all that. What's been fun too, another piece of marketing is this Haro, helpareporterout.com, the Haro.com. So it's been great because I see what reporters are asking from financial advisors. I'll send out kind of my piece on here. So they'll ask a question, I'll send out some answers. Sometimes they pick it up, sometimes they don't. When they pick it up, that's nice because you get a mention in the news or you get a link back to your website, which is a nice marketing thing. But even if not, that answer to the question, I get to save that now, and that could be easily turned into a blog or a podcast. So sometimes one thing is it's a chicken or egg thing. I'd say if you had to pick one, it's usually thinking of the idea and creating the podcast content around it, and then everything comes out from there. But what's good too is that you need to take care of or make use of any opportunities that are out there. So that one lady who happened to be find us through Smart Advisor, she happened to work with a company that was letting go of some folks. And she came to us because she went online and I bought her name as a lead, I suppose. And turns out she liked us. So she referred us to somebody else. And then a month later, somebody else came to us from that same company, but it was a lead that was purchased. And then another one. So next thing we know, we have three or four people at the same company. And every single one of them basically came to us because of going out and purchasing the leads. Well, now all of a sudden we're getting some expertise in this company. And so we decided, let's put together a webinar and focus on this company. It's Harley Davidson. We're in Milwaukee area. So Harley Davidson is a good company in the area, but they've just been focusing on some things that involve maybe turnover right now, recently, last year and a half. But we came up with a webinar, but we also came up with a checklist on here's what you do when you need to retire or get let go. We created a webpage specifically on our site. I reached out to every single person I knew on LinkedIn that was connected to Harley. And that's really easy. You just type in Harley in the search box and you hit connect. And some people will and some people won't. We sent out emails to people that we know through there. And so through this webinar, we connected with about 20 or 30 different people that got to see us giving away free value, like you said, about here's what we're seeing for folks. Here's what we're reading about in the different packets of information that they're coming out. So we gave people a process. Here's what you ought to be looking at for your retirement or for your severance, whatever it is. And interesting enough, one of our clients that came off of that, she was referred to us by a Harley employee, but she didn't call us. And then she got another email from this Harley employee and she went to the webinar though. And then when she went to the webinar at the end, I say, hey, give us a call. And I kick everyone over to a place where they can type in their name and email if they want to and reach out to us. She still didn't reach out from us. Well, it's a webinar. I get everyone's emails. So I just emailed everyone and I said, what questions, what brought you to the webinar? Well, then she responded back. So she had three or four opportunities to reach out to us, but it was adding the value of the webinar and then me reaching out to her and asking her, what questions do you have that got her interested? We started talking and now she's working with us as a client. And it's just been an interesting cycle that it all started with buying a lead from the Smart Advisor. And it got kind of sourced and created more by having the podcast. And then there's a little bit more momentum. So we created the guidebooks and the checklist and the webpage and the webinar. And we're kicking that out to people on LinkedIn as best as possible. Well, now you've got this chain of about 10 clients that are just kind of moving along from all these different sources that it's been our number one source, number one company that we've got new clients from in the last year and a half. And it's not one thing, it's the entire thing together, but it's also reaching out and making use of whatever the opportunity that presented itself is.
Yeah, what I like about what you're describing here is you've identified your market, which is people mm-hmm. that are in or near retirement, and that's pretty broad, okay? So there's a lot of people that are gonna fall under that bucket. And then you've further refined it and said, well, we have a local corporation here where I think there's a great opportunity for us to go narrow and deep with them mm-hmm. and really become known as the go-to financial advisor if you're gonna be rolling out of the company here. You become an expert in their retirement plan. And so now you're really starting to make some inroads there. You've got a really nice base of clients. And now you've mm-hmm. got clients at that firm that are referring their friends that are rolling out of that organization. And so mm-hmm. you start with the big idea, which is retirement. And then now we've got a particular company. And now you've got the specific ways that you're doing it from the podcast, from the free download, from the upgraded website that you've done. And so again, I want us all to be thinking in terms of a system here that when you've got that direction and you get all the moving parts of the system driving toward that North Star that you've really developed here, I think a lot mm-hmm. of powerful things can happen. And it's been fun to work with you and see how all these things have developed over time. So I appreciate you sharing all that detail there.
Yeah, absolutely.
So let's, anything else on the marketing? I also want to talk about this idea of motivational interviewing, which I know you spent some time learning about and actually effectively implementing. So anything else here on the marketing side that you want to be talking about here?
Yeah, I'll just finish up with the marketing, a little bit of COVID. So COVID hit, in a real force in a way, business-wise, about the middle of March of 2020. And previously we were buying leads from Smart Advisor, Wiser Advisor. And because of COVID, because everyone's at home and they're worried about their markets and their stock accounts and everything, they just all of a sudden had a huge amount of interest. And so they called me up and said, would you like to pay for more leads? You got them here. In fact, you basically run out of your budget around March 15th. So if you wanted to, you could buy more leads. And I thought, well, people need the help. Let's pay the money and try to get in front of more people. So oddly enough, from that time frame, the last lead that came in March was one of our biggest clients that came in as a new client for the entire year. If I had not taken the time to double the budget because we had an opportunity, I never would have met them. And they're one of the ones that has been one of our best referrers in the last year as well too. And so when you have a crisis in a way, being able to take that opportunity and put some money behind things, we were already set. All we had to do was just dial the dollars up to buy more leads because we had the whole system there ready to go. And that specifically, that one client, the last one of the month, never would have happened if we hadn't just said yes to that opportunity. And we wouldn't have said yes if we didn't have the system. We weren't already doing those things to begin with.
And along those lines, I think one of the things that you've done pretty well too is you're paying for advertising, you're paying for marketing, but then you're also monitoring the metrics and you're looking at what is the return on that investment. So tell me a little bit more about how you're doing that and how you think about the return on your marketing investment.
Yeah, two ways that I go about it in my mind, and you can tell me if this is wrong or not, but my thought is that whatever growth rate you want for the year, you basically ought to be spending that on marketing. If you're looking for a 10%, 15%, 20% growth rate, you ought to spend 10, 15, 20% of your revenue on your marketing. That's how you're going to get the growth. And as well too, if you are spending 15% on your marketing and you're not growing by 15%, perhaps something's going on with your marketing. So that's one way I approach it. Another way too, especially when you have these leads that you can purchase or you can track specific dollars going towards specific marketing avenues. I'm sure there's maybe better rules about this, but I figure if you can break even in a 12-month period, then you're doing all right. So if you spend $10,000 on marketing and you get $10,000 worth of revenue in that first 12 months period, especially if it's recurring, if it's not recurring, well, maybe we got to talk something different. But if it's recurring revenue that's created that breaks you even in the first 12 months, then in a way, business-wise, everything else in the future is gravy. So hopefully we're all good advisors here that can afford to defer revenue in a way to put money in today and then wait 12 months before it really starts coming back in a positive to you. But that's a pretty good return is when you have a 12-month window, 12-month break-even is not a bad return for a project.
Yeah, if you can get that 12-month payback period, I think that's definitely a good rule of thumb. And anybody doing better than 12 months, I think it's great. And if it's taken longer than 12 months, then definitely be thinking about some ways that you can try and improve that around the margins there. So good. Great. Well, anything else here on the marketing side before we chat a little bit about motivational interviewing?
I think we went through all the topics. Appreciate that. That's fun. I love talking about marketing. And my new favorite topic, as you'll find out, is motivational interviewing.
All right. Well, let's dig into that. So tell me, first of all, let's just start with what is motivational interviewing?
Yeah, well, I've been around for almost 18 years, go to a lot of different industry events. Now you get to do them all virtually. And just about every conference speaker says the key to being a good financial advisor is to ask good questions. I have yet to hear any one of them say, here's how to ask good questions. And so that's always bugged me for a little while on it. And then I don't know how it got introduced to me. I'm guessing a podcast because I listen to a good number of them. But somebody talked about this thing called motivational interviewing. And it might have been just a sentence, might have been just a minute, but it just clicked real quick of, I've got to learn more about this. And motivational interviewing is, I don't want to use the word tactic, but I will. But it's just a way to approach conversations. And it started years ago, maybe 30, 40 years ago, with counselors, with therapists that were helping people with their addictions, whatever that addiction might have been, helping people make a change when you got a really big kind of a impediment to that change, right? I'm assuming that addiction and all these different areas are pretty tough to change. And they thought that if we can help these people believe they can change it, they'll be more likely to change it. And so their definition, I'd say, if you're a motivational interviewing counselor or therapist, you would say it's a process of interacting with clients to help them align their behavior with their goals and their values. And that sounds a lot like financial planning as well, at least financial planning done right.
Yeah. And the way I like to think about motivational interviewing as well, right in line with what you're saying here, is this idea of change. And one way that people are not going to change is for you to say, hey, you need to change this behavior. You need to spend less. Yeah. Okay. That's not going to work. The other way, and this is what sports coaches try to do and coaches. And what I try to do is I don't tell people what they need to do. I try to, through the motivational interviewing, through asking the right questions, is get people to come to their own realization that they want to change.
Yeah.
And my role and your role and everyone listening's role as a financial advisor is to ask those questions that gets people to think about, I do want to change my behavior and here's why I want to change it. And I'm ready to change it. And I've got the skills and I've got the resources now to actually make this change. And I've got you as my financial advisor, who's going to help support me and guide me through making this change. So it's getting me to want to make the change as opposed to telling me I got to do this. And I think that's one of the breakthroughs with motivational interviewing. I think it goes back to Carl Rogers and some of his humanistic psychology that he did as well. So I think there's some great stuff. So if anybody listening to this, if you have not gone down the motivational interviewing rabbit hole, I definitely would encourage you, because I think it can definitely help in the interpersonal communication skills. So what else, Jeremy, have you learned, and how are you actually implementing this? Are there some specific questions that you happen to find that have been helpful in moving forward with this?
Yeah, you got it. Well, I'll just say, if anyone wants to learn more, go to motivationalinterviewing.org. And you're good at show notes, Steve, so I'm sure that might be in the show notes as people are there. But I read a little bit about it, got a book, did an online course, which was, I think, $90. So that's a pretty cheap investment to try to learn how to be better at asking questions. But what really got me improving on this skill, on this path of working with people, is doing a two-day workshop. So I went through, and on that website, themotivationalinterviewing.org, that's actually the network of trainers. There are people on there that can train you how to learn about and do motivational interview. That's what really got me improving and learning more about it. But what's interesting about it is they talk about change and what prevents change. A lot of times they like to use the word ambivalence, unresolved ambivalence, just kind of, I don't care if I change, I don't care if I don't change, in a way. And sometimes that happens. If you're a financial advisor, people walk in, they say, well, I'm trying to learn more, but I've been doing it on my own and I haven't used an advisor yet, so I'm not sure if it's worth it, right? That's ambivalence. For them, they haven't reached a pain level yet, in a way, to make a change. And they have yet to find a reason, kind of a bright side to having a financial advisor that makes it worth it to them to make a change. And I don't want to necessarily say that everyone needs a financial advisor, although they probably could use it. But the goal with motivational interviewing is having people come back and work with you and minimize any resistance that they might have to change. And the way to do it is exactly what you said. If people identify their own reasons to change, then they're far more likely to change. And if people walk in saying, I don't know if an advisor is really worth it to me, well, let's explore that. And there's ways to go about exploring it that help them almost make the change. If they don't choose an advisor, but they had the option to figure out if it's a good idea or not, they might feel actually better about it because they resolved their ambivalence. They said, I look down the road, I'm not going to use an advisor. But oftentimes they might look down that road and decide, I am going to choose an advisor. And what's so great about it is it's such a, the psychology term is self-efficacy. Like, it's people are taking control. It gives them hope, gives them confidence, brings their self-worth. It's empowering. So going through the process is such a good user experience for the prospect, for the client on there. I like to say that if we're an advisor, we really have two puzzles. One is, what should the client do? And number two is, how do you get them to do it? And that second part, how do you get the client to do what they really ought to do? That is far more difficult. We can all figure out what to do. You know, buy this, move your money there, do that. But helping them do the things that they want to do or need to do, that motivational interviewing, that process really helps them with that second part, helps them go about doing that.
Yeah. And I remember this old saying, we talk about change here. And part of the motivational interviewing process is really to help people make change. Like you said, people that are ambivalent about change. And so there's this old saying that says, people don't resist change. They resist being changed.
There you go. Yeah.
Yeah. And so that gets back to this idea that nobody wants to be told what to do. You know, they want to come to their own conclusion that this is what I want to do. And that's, to me, what motivational interviewing does, is it helps people want to change through the questions that you're asking. And I know there's certain techniques, and I don't know if you want to go into some of the details, but things like, you know, asking the open-ended questions, which I'm sure everyone listening to this knows, and reflective listening and some of those things. But yeah, if there's anything that you want to add in terms of some of the specifics of motivational interviewing and how you're actually implementing this with your clients.
Yeah, there's so much on it. Go to motivationalinterviewing.org and learn more about it. But since you brought up the open-ended questions, they like to say that there's four specific skills with motivational interviewing. And that's the first one, open-ended questions. The second one is affirmations, affirming what somebody has done or who they are. Reflecting on what they said, and summarizing. And notice how three of those don't involve questions. And so even though every conference speaker says the key is to ask good questions, a lot of times, and you'll learn with motivational interviewing, if somebody's asking a bunch of questions, right, who is it, Columbo, right? You ask all these questions, and in the TV movies, the robber breaks and he says all the right things. That doesn't happen in real life. If you're just bombarding somebody with questions, they feel attacked because questions can be attacking in a way. So yes, do questions, but do an open-ended question and then follow that with affirmations of you've saved a lot of money. That's great. Or reflecting and you say, well, you'd like to retire at 65. Like you're reflecting on what they said or summarizing, you know, that let me summarize here what I just heard from you and go through you're retiring in a year and you've been doing this all on your own, but you'd like to find somebody to help guide you through towards retirement. Would that be accurate? And you're summarizing what they're saying and it's showing that you are listening and it's not just you showing, you're doing it. But notice how three of the skills are not actually asking questions. So it's interesting that yes, ask good questions, but you can have a conversation without asking questions nonstop. And maybe try that. Try that with your significant other. Ask questions nonstop and see how quickly they end that conversation. But when you're affirming them and reflecting on what they had said and then summarizing it, that'd be a much better conversation. There's a whole lot more to it than that, but I'll just go through some questions because you asked that piece of it. In a way, if you're meeting with a prospect, they're looking to make a change and that change might be moving away from their advisor or that change might be choosing an advisor for the first time. And so some of the questions that we look at right away when we're trying to meet with somebody in a manner of speaking, our connection meetings are typically about an hour long. And I would say about 40 minutes of it is trying to grab as much of the information in a positive way, the empathic information, asking them more about what the client wants compared to spending an hour saying, here's what we do and here's how we do it, right? We do that last and we make sure that we spend twice as much time on them than on us on there. So I'll just say that real quick. But when people come in and you ask, how can we help? What brings you here today? They're going to tell you all kinds of stuff. And sometimes they aren't as specific. So you need to keep following up. So one might be what prompted you're looking right now. And then it turns out when they said, well, I need a financial advisor. Well, what prompted you're looking for an advisor right now? Well, I've got this lump sum pension offer. Well, now we know what's on their mind, right? They might not have said that right away. Another good question is, and what else, right? What else might be there? There's great questions there. What have you done so far? So now you're getting an idea of how have they approached their finances? What did you like about that? What did you not like about that? And I like to use that one second, because if I find out what they didn't like about their prior advisor, that's what the last thing is on their mind is a nice thing. But there's all kinds of other questions. What would you like from an advisor? You're just building up and learning what is it that they want? How would they like to work with somebody? You can even ask them, how would you prefer to pay them? And find, what do you mean? Well, you could pay them a commission, asset-based percentage. You could pay them an hourly fee. You're getting an idea of how do they want to work with you? What's the way that's going to make them feel the most comfortable so they can accomplish what it is that they need? And then after you go through some of those questions and more, it's good to summarize what it is they want. And when you summarize it, you're helping yourself out and you're helping them out to just know that we're on the same page. And what's also a nice key thing with motivational interviewing is asking permission. So you can say, well, if it's all right with you, what we find works best right now is just to have us go through the process. Would that be all right if I go through how we work with people? And they'll say, yes, you were going to do it anyways. But the fact that you asked permission just gives yourself a better conversation in that specific arena. And then from there, you can summarize how you work together and do some checking questions of how does this compare to what you've seen others do? Or how does that sound, right? This is a way to make sure that they're coming along with you as opposed to just ramming through your 30-minute spiel about how you are the greatest advisor in town. That's not going to sit well with too many people. So that's with prospects. And it's been a fun way to connect better with people. I'm definitely connecting a lot better with people, whether they, you know, become a client or not. We're connecting a lot better because we're having that type of conversation.
Yeah, a couple things that you said there that I just want to double click on. One is you mentioned that asking questions is just like one of the four parts of this process. And so that's why they call it motivational interviewing as opposed mm-hmm. to motivational interrogating.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. So it's not just about the questions that you're asking. And then the second thing that I thought was really key here, I mean, you said a lot of great things here, but one that I want to also mention is you said asking for permission. And mm-hmm. I think that is something that a lot of us don't do. And you can call it asking for permission. You can call it a prefacing comment or question. Mm-hmm. And I think that's so helpful because sometimes you might get into a deep conversation. And if you ask too deep of a question before you've really earned the right, I'm going to say, to mm-hmm. ask that kind of a question, it can also be very helpful to do exactly what you said, which is something like, you know, I'd like to ask you a question about such and such. And I just want to, you know, start with, you know, are you okay going there? Mm-hmm. Or, you know, just kind of setting the stage
right.
for what you're about to ask. So it doesn't feel like you're just hitting them out of left field with this thing. And I mm-hmm. think that is a really important, I'm going to call it a technique here that can help with the interpersonal communication. And I always like to preface this by saying mm-hmm. that what I'm talking about and what I'm sure you're talking about here, Jeremy, these are not tactics to manipulate people. These are just ways to help develop deeper relationships with people and to help people feel more comfortable opening up with you so that you can do your discovery here and so that you can learn more about them so that you can put together a financial plan that is more personalized to what they're looking for. So I think these are all tremendous ideas yeah. here that you're sharing, Jeremy.
Well, thank you. And you want to help move people along towards the goals that they want. And I'm just thinking of two right now that I kind of failed on in a way. And I thought, as soon as I took the motivational interviewing course, I thought if I only knew this 6 months earlier, we had somebody that called us and said, hey, I want to get some life insurance. And so we said, wonderful, let's get together. Got together with he and his wife, discovered what they needed, why they were asking about life insurance. And we said, all right, here's how much you need, and we'll send you the applications tomorrow. And they never returned them. And I'm thinking, I'm an idiot. I should have asked, would you like us to send you the applications? In my mind at the time, of course they want us to send them the applications. They call me asking for life insurance. How can I not help them by not sending them the life insurance applications? And so they ended up, word got back to us that we were a little too pushy. And I'm definitely not a pushy guy in any way. But somebody that calls you and wants to buy something, and if that's the process is to send them the application, say, we usually, you know, do you mind if I send you the application? Or perhaps, would you prefer the application in mail or by email? And let them be in charge. They'll be a lot better off in their finances if they take charge. In that case, I don't know if they got the insurance or not. We had another person call us in and said, I need some financial planning. I met with them, met with him by phone. And then it turned out kind of his situation was going to be better off with a different advisor in our office. And so I called and introduced him to the other advisor, and they had a good conversation, and we were all set to go. We booked the time. Here's when she'll come over and get things started. So she went to his house, and this is the first time, by the way, that the wife happened to be part of the conversation. And so the first thing that this other advisor did is she pulled out the financial planning contract that had, you know, whatever the dollar amount was right away and said, let's, you know, get this out of the way. Well, that's not quite the way to go about it. And if we had gone through the motivational interviewing to begin with, we might have summarized of what the conversation had already been with the husband. We probably would have started over the conversation with the wife. She's brand new to it. But to go in right away without permission and to just instantly show the contract, they didn't work with us. And so I don't know, it's a couple years later, I don't know if they've actually accomplished their financial goals. And so granting, giving them the permission or asking them for permission, motivating them or empowering them to take charge of the finances pushes them a lot closer to their goals than maybe a take charge kind of attitude, which got a few examples of when that happened for us in a bad way.
Yeah, well, I appreciate you sharing those. And this really starts dipping into self-determination theory, where people want to have autonomy over decision-making. And if you do come across as too pushy, which I know you're not,
yeah.
But if you do, it's going to backfire. And
yep.
So, yeah, so great. Well, this has been great, Jeremy. Anything else here that you want to share or add that we haven't talked about yet?
Yeah, on the motivational interviewing part, we've talked a little bit more on how it works when somebody perhaps chooses you as advisor, but we owe our clients a duty to help them through different areas. And it's not our job to impose our values. And there's a lot of things that are involved. If we're their financial planners, it's not all about buying and selling stocks and bonds, not even all about just save money on taxes, that kind of things. It's empowering them. It's going through. A lot of times clients are trying to debate whether they give money to their kids. You meet with a 70-year-old client and they're trying to figure out, should I give money to my kids now or later? The wrong answer is yes, you should, or no, you shouldn't, or here's how much. But you can use these conversational techniques to help them work through their ambivalence and help them make a decision that they're going to enjoy a lot more. Or perhaps a client's gone through and said, here's what I need and here's what I'm looking for with my retirement, with my finances. And you've put together this great plan that involves Roth conversions and postponing your Social Security and doing this with your pension and that with your accounts. Well, unless they've bought into it, they're not as likely to go through with that great, stellar, shiny plan that you put together. So you can go through the conversation of what is it that they're looking to do and talk to them about this in a way that's going to be a lot better for your clients. They're going to be more empowered. They're going to make more of the better decisions. And that's our goal, is to help people feel better about their money so they make better decisions about their money. And motivational interviewing is definitely not a tactic to get more clients, but it is a conversational technique to make that relationship deeper and help your clients that are already clients in a way that is beyond just the numbers.
Excellent. All right. Well, Jeremy, if anyone wants to reach out to you, what's the best way for folks to connect with you?
Yeah, our website is keilfp.com, keilfp.com. I'm on LinkedIn, Jeremy Keil, Keil. You can find me there. Love to reach out with anyone with questions or connections. Yeah.
Excellent. Well, great. Well, we'll have some show notes at stevesandusky.com and you can look up this episode. So Jeremy, this is great. Appreciate it. As always, it's great to connect with you. And thank you for sharing all your wisdom here.
Yeah, you too, Steve. Nice seeing you.